Hello, Schmoville. Well, episode 19 is here. It is still phase 2 of the podcast channel. If you are fans of the podcast as it is today, then you will be familiar with one of our guests on the show. Actually, if you've just seen our Captain America 2 review, you definitely know who this is. And if you read on the website, Mark Reilly, our editor-in-chief, who was a guest, I think it was episode 6 of the podcast. Well, now he's back for episode 18. However, this episode is so old, Mark Reilly was actually still married at the point of this podcast. So at the time, he and his ex-wife were married at the time, but they had just done an independent film called Gray Skies. They were on the show to talk about that show and talk about the process of how to make an independent film and sell it and all that stuff. And then we talked a little bit about some of our favorite independent films. It's actually a really good podcast to go back and forth and the process of how you get a smaller film developed. So I would definitely check this one out if you haven't. And it's also an exploration into Yodi's past. So enjoy this episode. Comment and let us know what you think. And thanks for checking out the Schmoes Know podcast.
Okay, guys, welcome back to the Schmoes Know podcast. Yay! I'm Christian Harloff.
A very excited Christian Harloff, and I am, as always, Mark Ellis. I have not changed my name.
No, you haven't. Why wouldn't I be excited?
We got a lot of stuff to get to today, so I'm very excited.
Yeah, okay, so listen to me. I have some friends today.
We have some friends on today.
No, they don't really like you. Now, they're friends of mine. Now,
what?
You guys know, Schmoes fans will know one of our guests, and that's Mark Reilly.
Hello.
Hey, Mark. Mark has, if you guys have been listening to our podcast, Mark was on for our our X-Men podcast, and it is our third most listened to podcast. How about that?
Which, I was number 2 at one point, right? But then that Jeremy Johns character came on.
Yeah, Jeremy is the leader right now, and then Katie Sackhoff is now a couple behind you. You leaped over Katie Sackhoff.
I did.
You did.
That's pretty impressive work, my friend.
Then you know what that means.
What?
People love X-Men.
I know. I guess I don't like Battlestar Galactica much anymore.
No, but listen, so Mark is here, which is special, but not as special as who he has beside him, and that, of course, is his lovely wife, Stacy. Hi, Stacy.
Hi, Christian. Thanks.
No problem. Now, why are Stacy and Mark with us, the two?
They're here to class up the podcast, Christian.
That's right. The two hooligans. Why are they joining us?
Especially in my shirt.
That's right.
That's right. Mark Reilly does not have a shirt on called Dick Force, I promise.
This says Dick Force. That's
the second time.
It's not even spelled right.
It looks like something that Styles from Teen Wolf would wear.
It does.
It's a real, what are you looking at, dick nose kind of situation.
Exactly. Can you please ask the question?
What is a dick for?
For peeing with.
Oh, Dick Four. I thought it was Dick Force.
Dude, no. You never did that in school? Like, you'd be like, hey, you're a Dick Four. And then somebody would be like, what's a Dick Four? And then you're like,
for peeing.
I thought it was like you. I thought you were like the Power Ranger that kicked out of the crew and they wouldn't let him come back.
No, that's from Spies Like Us, too.
Oh, okay.
Remember?
I apologize.
Come on, Christian.
I'm sorry.
Geez,
I've been sleeping.
How do I even let you host this thing?
I don't know. I don't know why anybody lets me do anything anymore.
Sham schmo.
That's right. Now, Mark and Stacy are here because they have done something pretty incredible. Besides joining us today.
Besides staying married.
Yes.
Yeah, that's true. Quite the feat.
That's right.
True.
They stayed married. That's exactly. They're here to talk about Dr. Phil-like questions today. No. They have done something really incredible. We all live in Los Angeles. Mark and Stacy. Mark's a very talented writer. Stacy is a very talented actress, plus she's a producer. And they said, you know what? We're kind of sick of trying to go through the normal channels to get shit done. Let's do it ourselves. Mm-hmm. So Mark wrote a script called Gray Skies, and that was years and years ago he wrote this, I believe.
Yeah, it started 2008, September.
Okay.
Is when you started writing it. That was your first day at the Coffee Bean.
Exactly.
That's right. Well, let's talk about this before we get into, you know, the movie itself.
They
made an independent film. They got it. They got the thing. It's bought. It's paid for. I mean, everything is good, but it's not as easy as it sounds. And that's what we're going to get into. We're going to get into the process of how Mark thought of it, how Stacy said, fuck yeah, let's make it, how they put together a cast, how they shot the, you know, they shot it, everything that went right.
How to make an independent film.
Right, everything that went right, everything that went wrong.
Yeah, what not to do.
What not to do.
Everything. I mean,
and what to do, and then now it's coming out on DVD.
Well, let's start, don't jump ahead. Let's start.
That was a shameless plug.
That was, that's what.
Grace Guys.
Grace Guys coming out on DVD.
October 11th.
See, look at that.
Oh, so, okay, so it's coming out October 11th.
It is, but I want Christian to stay, you know, my husband will shamelessly get him off track.
So from 2008 until October 11th, 2011
right.
is when this baby started. And you started writing and you just had this you had this concept.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's talk about that. Let's first, you know, why don't you guys tell us, well, tell me how you thought of the idea, and then kind of through the getting idea, you can kind of tell us what it's about as you're thinking about the idea. So that way there'll be the people will know that way.
Okay, well, it actually started probably in like 2005. I got the idea with Michael Cronaccia. We were doing the Star Wars trilogy in 30 minutes. We came up with the idea backstage. We were talking about what it would be like to do a horror movie with, instead of like Jason outside in the woods, it was aliens. And one location, and hey, we can shoot this. So then fast forward, we get married. I meet Stacy.
You and Michael Cronaccia get married.
Yeah, me and Michael Cornaccia get
that's
married.
That's legal here now.
They went
it's
to
legal, yeah. yeah, no, me and Stacy get married 2008. Stacy and I.
But I didn't know him, in all fairness. I did not know him when he and Michael conceived the idea.
That's correct.
Oh, really? Yeah. So you guys, when did you guys meet?
Well, we started dating in 2006, so I guess technically we had met, but I was just, you know.
So that one was on the back burner. It was in the Reilly Cave.
That's right.
Yes. Okay.
And then I started writing it in 2008. This was after we got married, and we went to and I kind of, you know, wrote myself into a corner, and then we went for Christmas vacation. We went and stayed with Stacy's mom in Michigan.
She had just moved there, like I guess, like 8 years ago at that point, or 7 years ago.
Okay.
Right. With this beautiful house, and I sat there and I went, "We could do it here." Like, and
well, let me ask you this then: where did you
make the movie? Not you know, looking at Stacy. Stacy, your mom's place is kind of romantic.
Did you originally think of the idea for anywhere else besides like Michigan, or is it just the woods in general?
It was just a cabin, woods in general.
And it happened to fall
in. And you
place.
Hadn't really written it, because what happened is we were sitting, they had had the idea, and we were sitting there, and I had just been really frustrated as an actress, just going, I'm never getting the opportunities that I want. I'm, you know, out there calling in favors all the time, going on auditions, but never enough. And so I thought, you know, what the hell? I have a really good business mind. I could raise the money. And I told him if he wrote a really strong female lead for me, that I would raise all the money.
Yep.
So he really kicked it into gear in Michigan. And while we were there, my mom and her boyfriend both said, you know, like they'll do all the catering, they'll house everybody. So then Mark was just free to just worry about the creative part.
So you didn't, Mark didn't make you audition?
No.
Yeah. Well, he did.
I believe there was a
casting couch.
Exactly.
Yeah,
that's
true.
Yeah,
but that was in 2006 at their first party.
That's right, the Halloween party.
Yeah, that was a great movie. I thought about shit. What I got to write now?
Yeah, I had half the script done, and it was really bad. And then Stacy. You know, she's a hustler. She was like, yeah, I can get the money. And I'm like, wow, okay. And then I figured, and also.
Let me cut you off. That was a terrible plug. You said, I just wrote a script and it was bad. But
No. Half of it. I thought it wasn't, half of it I wasn't happy with.
But you were still excited about the idea.
Yeah, so okay. I love the idea.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
And then you get a little bit of money behind it. You get momentum, and you get excited.
You also get you're also sitting in the middle of nowhere watching the snow fall outside the window, and you get creative.
So it's about shining. You know, it's either creative, like, or shining. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Like he had 10 days uninterrupted to just sit there, and he did with his scarf and a hat on, and it was 90 degrees in the house.
Yeah. It was cold. It was cold out outside.
Living in Southern California really turns you into a kind of a wuss.
Yeah.
It gets below 70 out here, and I'm like, what is this, Green Bay? This is terrible.
It's true.
Well, long story short, I finished it there, and then...
And it was good. It wasn't bad.
Yeah, thank you, honey.
Aww.
And then...
I would like people to buy this DVD, Mark.
Well, no, but it's...
It's the process.
But that is the process.
We're talking about the process, writing, and you know...
Look, any writer or director that you get, you can... I mean, you go and talk to Scorsese about Goodfellas, you probably it sucks. there's no writer that thinks it's good, but you do have to, listening, slap the writer in the face and go, look, you know it was good. Cut it out.
Well, after a first draft, right. I mean, you gotta take some notes. And while I was polishing it up, Stacy went out and kicked some ass and got
Now, how do you
everything?
Yeah, that's how do you raise say, yeah. money? Because, I mean, again, I would just like to be able to pay my rent on a more consistent basis. How did you go out and raise money? Well, what are the kind of steps you take?
You know, to be honest with you, and I know people say this all the time, I got incredibly lucky. We actually went to none of my family was involved. They were, you know, my dad wouldn't give me a dollar. He's like, you're going to figure this out on your own. And it was the best thing he could have done, because if he had just given me the money, I wouldn't have learned anything. I wouldn't have learned, you know, the hustle and how to learn about how to even raise money. So I had been taking a bunch of classes at UCLA about producing, about financing. And then there's this amazing thing called Section 181 where...
So it's not luck. Oh, I got lucky. No, you didn't. You went.
She knew what she was doing.
You took classes and you started getting educated and you went out and you...
Luck is I was walking in the woods. I find a leprechaun who happens to be injured so I can capture him.
He gave me his gold.
And he made me Brad Pitt.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's luck.
But she didn't, and these classes kind of awakened the sleeping giant, right?
Because I am exceptionally left-brained, and Mark is very right-brained. So,
that's right.
You know, I had all of this information, so it inspired me to start talking to people about would they be interested, and here are the benefits that even if you don't make your money back in this year, you get, you know, this gigantic write-off. So I found two businessmen who were friends of my mom and her boyfriend in Michigan who were thrilled with the idea of, you know, doing something even more exciting
than
oil and real estate deals, which were, you know, more sure bets at that time. You know, the market hadn't tanked yet. But, you know, I also wasn't asking for millions of dollars. I was saying, you know, let's get our feet wet. Let's see how it is. I will work harder for you than anyone you've ever met. And, you know, still to this day, I'm working on this film. So that part's true. But they were just really gracious and really generous. And they trusted me, which I have to say is the best gift of this entire film, that two people just put all of their faith in me and said, okay, we trust you. And you know, they came to set all the time. So we made it a really fun experience for them. So they've had a lot of fun learning about the movie business.
See, that's how you do. That's how you raise money if you actually want to get something done. I was thinking, like, I guess they had a lot of bake sales. Like, I don't know how you raise money for a film.
Well, you got to find people that you with certain channels and whatnot. So I think that's, you know, for people out there who are looking to do an independent film, you just have to kind of look and. It's all about connections everywhere you go, because even though, again, like, I kid you with the luck thing, it's not just luck, because it's like you have to go and you have to know, well, I know this person who knows this person who might know this person. And when you make that one phone call that you think, oh, I'm not going to do that. If you make that phone call or you send that email, that could be the email that changes.
Or you send the 10th email and you just bang down the door, you know.
Well, that's why also, you get 7,000 Facebook schmoes a day.
There's a lot of people, too, that go out just thinking, I feel like it's like, oh, I just got to find a guy with money or a businessman or somebody. But Stacy went and found these guys and it didn't just ask for money, but she had a plan.
Right.
She's like, Section 181, you're going to make, you're going to be able to write off this money like this way. And then the following year, you know, if you make the money back, you get, what was it, 90? You only have to write off 90%.
You get to write off 10% of the income above the initial investment.
1090.
Exactly, right.
Yeah.
It was the 10%.
I'm dyslexic. 90%.
It's all right.
This is why she does the business and I write the scripts.
Just stick to the aliens.
Definitely right brain. Yeah.
So the aliens come down from faith, right?
And nerd.
Oh, sorry. They have ray guns.
All right. So you go and you tell your husband, stay away from the cash.
Hands off.
Which is funny. We'll get to the shooting part of it because I was in charge of the cash then.
Well, good Lord. Might as well give the aliens.
He had a 3-week window to not fuck up.
Right. Well, but that's the thing, though. So you get the money. They say, okay, we're in, the investors.
Right.
Now, where does it come to – now you go back to Mark, and he's like, okay, now I've got the script. It's done. Where do you go next?
Then I start stepping on his toes and going, hurry the heck up, because we're shooting in September, and I hope the script is done. So because, you know, the whole thing with the money is there needs to be a time frame of, you know, this is our shooting schedule. This is how long post will take. This is when I'm ready to go to market and find the distributors, the foreign sales guys. So Mark had a really solid draft done. And then, you know, I read it and gave him two notes out of like 90 pages. And so he didn't talk to me for 3 days.
So wait.
Yeah, I was really upset by that.
Right there. No, wait a minute. So now, normally in general, the wife is the boss. In general.
Right.
Now so I've heard.
Now you're the boss of everything.
Yeah.
Like everything. Mm-hmm. So your head's exploding at this point, Mark.
It made marriage a challenge.
Right. So, I mean, because it's like, it's not only, hey, did you take out the trash? It's, hey, did you take the trash? And why is my character not in this one?
Right.
Yeah. And why aren't
I not
you finished?
In this scene?
Right.
Yeah.
And so, I had to pick my battles. And one of them was when she gave me two notes. I did. I left.
He didn't talk
I was
to me
upset.
For 3 days.
Does that hurt the creative process? I'm serious. Like, does it, like,
a little bit.
Okay.
Mark said it. He didn't say it. I said for the like immediately after. I said we'll never work together again.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Oh, really?
It's got
to
be tough.
It's not worth it because I always say it's easier to find a business partner than a life partner.
Yeah.
So I have found the person who is my partner for my next film, but Mark kept saying we can do it, we can figure it out. And I'm like, no, I don't want to figure it out.
Right.
I don't want, like you said, Christian, I don't want to be the boss at home and the boss of his life, like telling him where's the script and you know.
Right. Yeah, it's kind of strange, especially when you're like, well, especially as because Mark and I, we worked on stuff in the past too. It's like you know what scene that you like and you know what characters you like. No matter who your boss is, they're going to bitch about it.
Yeah,
but when it's your wife.
Yeah.
Now you got to be very careful about how you approach it because you want to fight for what you want, but you also want to be able to not sleep on the couch.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
And it becomes something too, like, you know, we became the two main producers and, you know, you're just, your whole life is this movie and you're going to bed and you're talking about the movie and you're waking up and you're talking about the movie and then you're taking the dogs out and then you're talking about the movie and it's just,
it's your life.
It's ridiculous.
Well, that's something that I wanted to talk to Stacy about was that, and once we get a little more into it, we can talk in depth on this, but something that I found, I mean, you're producing, which is taking up all your time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But you're starring in it. Like, mm-hmm. as your first project is like, really, did that, like, again, how do you have all your hair? I mean, I look at Braveheart. I look at Mel Gibson and Braveheart. And I wonder how he did it. And then and he had all this support behind him as to where you're doing it by yourself, more or less, you know?
Yeah.
How do you do that?
It was a huge learning curve, and that was, you know, kind of what I always thought is that, you know, I could have gone to grad school or I could have made this movie. And at least with this movie, I have the chance to recoup money I would have just lost going to grad school.
Right.
It did teach me that, you know, the next film I do, I either just want to be the main producer and then take a tiny 2 or 3 day small supporting role, or I want to be the star and just be an executive producer and ultimately tell people what to do once a week.
Yeah, that's going to be tough.
Yeah,
that's going to be tough. Because I think that every time you're still like, Stacy, stay away from the monitors. Stay away from the monitors. Just worry on your scene. Work about your scene. Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me the day you say, honey, stop breaking my balls. The script's done.
Well, it was around March. I remember March.
It's over.
Yeah.
March
of 2009.
Okay.
We did 2009.
Yeah. We pretty much said, okay, this is done. And we started to do pre-production and we started to kind of gather our people. Right?
Yep.
And then, you guys were actually going to shoot in Michigan, right? That's where it ended up.
That's another thing
I should have actually added about financing.
Yeah. Exactly.
42% of every dollar we spent there. Well, I mean, it was between 30 and 42, and I did as many core communities as I could, which means 42%. So a huge piece of our financing, like our post-production budget, came from the state of Michigan.
Yeah.
Wow. So that was another, you know.
How did you do that?
Because they, at the time, were having incredible tax incentives.
Okay.
Yeah.
Where they were giving back, you know, it was a 40% incentive for every in-state spend. So obviously anyone I hired here, any of my post guys, I didn't get a penny on them, but we hired our entire crew out of Michigan.
Wow, thank you. Go Wolverines.
That's it. It was amazing because right down the street they're shooting the Red Dawn remake.
Oh, yeah, our stunt guy
our stunt
from
guy
still hasn't come out. You guys already have it on DVD.
I know, right?
We like shot and distributed.
And they were shooting, I mean, our first AD then went off and did Harold and Kumar Christmas 3D.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They shot Scream 4. They like all these huge Hollywood movies came out to Michigan to get this tax credit.
By the way, I wanted to thank you guys for not making this movie in 3D.
Oh my God.
You're welcome.
Never.
I don't even know.
It's an alien picture. We got to put it in 3D or else the kids won't see it.
Pass.
I know.
Sorry, Mark. So the script, March, you say.
You're done with the Smith Corona. You got a script. It's pre-production time. Let's get this baby
you finish
shot.
The joint. You put down the script.
Right. It's done, baby.
I have a little bit of a change. There's aliens in it now.
And your character dies now at the beginning.
Hey, but I will say, as an actress, that was incredibly convenient because anytime I had a question, I just had to like roll over in bed and be like, so when Jenny does this.
Yeah, I'm sure it's real convenient for him.
Yeah.
It was like, it is very romantic.
That's when the bathroom becomes your office really quick.
I'll show you what your motivation is for this thing.
Right. It was wonderful. Yeah.
So your stomach still hurt, Mark?
Yeah, Indian food. So you guys actually chilled in Michigan then for a while shooting. How long was the actual shooting process?
So yeah, then we went. So we got everything. We got everything set. We went to in September. We drove.
Don't leave that out.
Yeah,
we got to talk about the drive.
3 days straight with 2 dogs in the car.
Wow.
Yeah, we drove with our director, our DP,
to scout and stuff.
No.
Well, we did get out there a week early. And then also with our DP and also Michael Cornaccia drove. We drove out to give ourselves a week of hardcore pre-production.
Prep,
walking around the set, which is AKA my mom's 100 acres.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we went and kind of like shot stuff and just saw how everything looked. We shot a little B-roll.
Yeah, thank God for Gavin Fisher, our DP. He just started shooting. And
B-roll stuff, right?
Yeah, and we used a lot of it because it was just great to cut to. Right. It added a mood.
More than we thought we were going to use.
More than we thought we were going to use, okay. And it added a great mood. But
well, at this point then, so you guys are going right into the fact that this is a week right as you're driving up to start shooting. Well, mm-hmm. before we jumped over casting.
Yeah. Oh, which...
Yeah.
Well, we know how the lead was in it, yes, but everybody else. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah,
I actually was an uncredited casting director on this film. I mean, literally, I've never worn more hats
in
my
casting.
Life. I used to work for Jeannie McCarthy and Jewel Bestrup, who have now gone separate ways. But I worked in casting for a year, so I knew the entire process. So I put out the breakdown, you know, did all the online casting, mm-hmm. dealt with the agents, dealt with the managers, ran the sessions.
Was Michael Cornaccia chubby when you cast him originally?
Yes.
Mark wrote it for him actually being heavier. Oh, that's a good question, Christian.
Yeah. I'm just curious, because I know Michael Cornaccia, who was a guy, he was actually, Mark Ellis and I have worked with him in the past, and he was a very jovial soul, and now he's Jonah Hill himself.
He's thin now.
Yeah, he's really
thin.
He's
skinnier than you are.
Yeah. Oh, let's not go crazy.
He's close. Yeah. He's taller.
Yeah, I changed a line for that.
Yeah.
Brilliant change on my
tear
part.
Tear coming down your eye as you had to change. Okay,
but
so
everybody
casting.
Else was, yeah. And then we had always, Mark had written it with Jeff Schutze in mind to play Michael's partner, because at the time they were partners.
Okay.
So Mark had always seen Jeff Schutze, a.k.a. Jeff Bott, in that role. And then everyone else was audition.
Yeah, we auditioned.
Jeff played Brian?
Yes, that's right. Yeah, he played Brian. The amazing Anne Griffin was a find. Her agents had actually submitted her for a tiny role in the film that was supposed to be a Michigan local hire. And the director and I both saw her. I pulled her over and I brought her into the main lead file. And then the director saw her and was like...
And Anne, this is your rival in the film?
Yes, in the film. Not in real life, she's wonderful. She's one of my best friends.
Okay. Do you just like rent out an office to have casting in, or do you just have them come over to your house? Or how does that work? Like,
that's cast. A good question.
Was that your apartment while you were sleeping?
Yeah. Don't you remember, Mark? We auditioned in your bedroom. Yeah. You were terrible, by the way.
So
you slept the whole time.
Yeah.
Got probed.
We did a place called Cast, which is actually fantastic because it's free for casting directors and directors, people that have a project. But you upload the actors' auditions and you give them feedback. And so it's actually great as an actor and as a casting director on the film because you can see your audition and you can see what you do right, what you do wrong, and you can read instant feedback, which when you go to a normal audition, I mean, actors listening to this will know, you never know unless you get the job.
Right.
So, everybody, and Jeff Lorch came in and auditioned, blew us away, you know, played guitar. Mm-hmm. Kai, our director, found him.
How did you get your director? Obviously, you got the director before the cast.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah,
so. It was just some farmhand in Michigan they picked up on the way.
Local
He was Amish.
Homeless guy.
Yeah. Stacy did a short called Cupcake and had a great time with it, and then we went to the premiere. And we try to have this other director, a great guy named Nick Simon, who was shooting his own movie, and now that's coming out, and Lionsgate bought that. So he was shooting at the same time. We were like, so it just didn't work out, and Stacy and I both looked at each other and said, well, maybe Kai Blackwood, who directed her
Cupcake. This
Cupcake.
Really creepy, and it was a horror short, so it was right in the same vein. It was right up his alley.
Yeah, so we asked him to do it, and he was like, yeah.
Okay, so now you have the director. Now you have the cast. Now you're driving with the dogs. You have the B-roll.
Yep.
You get to the first day, and you're ready, and you're sweating down your face. You're ready. The stress is going. Take us there. What's going on first day of shooting?
First day of shooting was wonderful.
Yeah?
Yeah, it was. It's interesting because we started with.
Wait, Stacey gave you a face.
I know you did.
Yeah, I mean, I just remember showing up to the makeup chair, which was literally.
Stacey's like, that's the day I punched you in the face.
Yeah,
might have been.
It was downstairs, and I remember going to the makeup. Like my call was like 7:30 or 8 a.m. or something, and I get there and there's no makeup artist, there's no crew, and then I realized they had scheduled a crew meeting at the exact same time as my call time. And so I was like, guys, you shouldn't call the actors if you're having a meeting because then nobody's there to do my makeup.
Right.
So like those
talk
are
about
like
the learning the process, tiny,
you know, and then it ended up taking. Like an hour and a half to get me completely ready because we shot the very end scene of the film first.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, so that's a fun fact. Literally the very last scene.
You didn't go Ron Howard on this one.
No. Okay. We did later. I mean, from that point on. But
you always wonder about that when you're watching a movie. You know, what they shoot first. Yeah.
Out of sequence. Yeah. And it's easier to go in order, obviously. Right.
I guess you had a different experience.
Not always. I mean,
sometimes. Oh, we just mean for the actors. Not for everybody else. For everybody else, if you're going to be in this office building, the first and last scene, shoot it all.
Yes, absolutely.
I just remember being late to set because it took so long to get me made up and have like the thing behind my neck. So that's
interesting in general though, because like from the lead actress and producer's point of view, it's kind of a horrific first day, and then for the writer, it's not as bad because it's like okay, I have my scene's ready.
Riley didn't have to be in makeup.
I didn't have to.
Stuff in and his also, face.
With donuts from Cobbs and Donuts.
Craft services is the best part so far, babies.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, the reason I said it was nice because it was like the weather hadn't turned bad yet.
It was the most beautiful
Michigan.
Day ever.
It's Michigan. It's a beautiful day. It's warm. I'm walking around in shorts. You know, it's like the first movie, you know, like you're like, oh my God, this is exciting. Before all
with
the
that voice too,
yeah, with that voice,
and you have 10 days, right? You guys had 10 days to shoot.
18. We 18. Did 3 6-day weeks.
Do you start to get nervous?
3 6-day weeks.
Start to get nervous that you're not going to get all the shots.
Oh my God!
Yeah,
yes.
Mark, that's an excellent question because
thank you.
That's what Mark said.
Please don't compliment him. He gets very excited.
It just ruins his ego. Yeah, no, that's why Mark said it was a great day because honestly, that first day we were ahead of schedule.
Yeah, yeah.
So we were excited. Like even though you know I ended up being late to set, you know we got everything we needed. But then after that. Things started to get a little bit behind and a little bit behind, and he got worried about the coverage, and then I would notice things weren't getting.
And that was that because director wanted more than you guys wanted to shoot, or was it more because actors were fucking up their lines? What was the cause of the behind the scenes?
Generally, it was a lack of organization. Mm-hmm. On pretty much everybody's part.
Well, it's the first time.
That's to be expected.
Yeah.
Yeah. We did a lot of waiting around.
Right.
Because I was going to say that, like, I always wanted to be shooting. If something was down, I would.
Yeah.
This is where, like, I wasn't, like, loved on set, to be honest with you. And then I was like, you know what?
She needs to be.
Yeah.
She,
it's not my job to be liked. It's my job to be respected.
But that's also tough, though, to know as the actress.
Right.
Yeah.
Because it would mess with me in scenes.
Right.
When I was, you know, if we were sitting waiting for a Steadicam to be set up, I wanted them to throw up sticks. And shoot the front door, or shoot somebody entering or leaving. So I always wanted to be shooting more.
Mm-hmm.
Did you find your brain, like, while you were acting, did you ever find yourself, like, worried about the shot, or were you in character and it was afterwards?
I would say most times I was really in it. A few times things happened that it was, like, it was incredibly hard to focus.
Yeah.
And it was really frustrating, and I was kind of like, that's where I needed... You know, I felt like I needed another producer like me on set because Mark is so nice and friends with everybody, and I needed somebody else who didn't mind being hated.
Right.
And I didn't have that, to be honest with you. I didn't have the other producer that was like, I don't give a shit. If you don't like me, here's what's going to happen.
Good cop, bad cop.
Yeah.
But the bad cop happens to be in the middle
actor.
Of the... Right.
Yeah, I can't be so hated because I'm being an actor, so I don't want people to light me poorly.
Here she comes, hide the drugs.
Well, the thing was, I was going thinking I was going to just have watch my script be made. So, you know, and it was like everything, we took care of everything, and it's like, okay, great. And we had people to do the certain things that needed to be done as a producer, and then all of a sudden it was all on me.
Well, I think the answer to Christian's question ultimately is it's all about expectations. And I feel like that's in life, in marriage, in movies. It's just, you know, I should have stated clearly, you know, I thought I had stated to Mark, like, I need you to do X, Y, and Z, but he had thought he was going to just sit there and be able to be the writer and
He's just a fan. He just shows up with a sign that says, go, Grace God.
Right, with his little script book.
I created that alien.
Well, you know, I was wanting to make sure the script was working, you know, it's in that capacity.
Well, you're going into creative, and you're on the technical, too. So,
so that got in the way, too. And then,
how do you get past that? How do you go? Okay, let's tie it up now. Let's get this thing in motion, and let's get this movie.
Let's get it back on track. If you start being late and there's delays, how do you catch up in time?
I think you pick your battles for sure, because I think there were times when Mark and Kai were just really in love with certain ideas, or even Gavin and Kai would be like, Stacy, we really want to spend a day in a plane. And I was like, first of all, I'm not paying for that. Second of all, no.
I wanted
no, our, like insurance.
The DP
like,
and director wanted to fly a plane over the house. And we're like, hmm.
Yeah. And, wow. I, you know, being like the hard ass that I am, I'm like, listen, I've flown Cessnas. You can't open a window in the air. It's just basic physics. Just letting you know.
You flown Cessnas?
Yes.
Wow. You have a lot of hats.
Yeah.
Man.
I need to focus. But
she flew here.
She's also the president of the United States. I didn't know if you knew this.
No, but that's like the stuff that doesn't get me fans. Because they're like, how do you know about this? How do you know about that? And I'm like, well, I'm not renting you a plane. So, but I mean, I think basically it's just, you know, they would want certain things. And then I would say, well, we're not going to do this, but how about we do this? And then we'd have to compromise. So it was all about picking our battles.
Crane.
And so you pick your battles and you shoot all this stuff, but you're still happy with everything you got. Like, you don't feel like you didn't compromise the artistic integrity of the movie because you had to make certain choices that maybe you didn't know you'd have to make.
I think there's always, honestly, Mark, I feel like there's a little bit of that. I mean, Chris Nolan might feel like that on Inception, and we feel like that on this tiny, tiny movie. I think that always happens where some things work out better than you had ever hoped, and other things are like, oh, I still wish I had that one shot.
And Chris Nolan did one in Alien 4 Inception, so.
Yeah, well, Chris Nolan also, right. We'll talk about him a little later, too, is part of one of my favorite independent films. People don't realize it's an independent film, and that's Memento.
Memento.
We'll talk about that.
Guy Pearce.
Yes, we'll talk about that a little later. So,
yeah.
But one of the things
you're so good at teasing for the pod. Nobody keeps a listener for the full hour like Christian. Like,
yeah,
he's
gifted.
Yeah, we're about to give away $1 million in free chocolate for the rest of your life. That's coming up later. Right now,
I've been watching news. Man dies. Watch in about 20 minutes. So, all right. Well, here's a question I have though, Stacey. Like, so. At points, you know that, like you said, you're the technical. You want to make sure that everything's good. You're also on your character. At some point, though, and I know it's hard for women to do, no offense, but like say you're wrong sometimes, too. Like, were there times where you were like, wait a minute, maybe the creative process, maybe I should kind of step back here a little bit and let the writer do it? Or you're just like, you knew it. You were taking over at this point.
Christian, you know what I think right now? I think that Mark Reilly put you up to that question.
No, he did not. I swear to God.
Riley's sweating right now. He's like, oh, how's this going to go?
No, I'm actually curious.
I'm
going to
be honest with you. Here's the thing. I literally, and this is a true story, I took Mark aside after the third day because he...
I punched him in the grill.
I threatened.
I think so.
I've never raised a hand to my husband. Uh-huh. I took him aside the third day because he and Kai are both so creative. And again, that's why I'm attracted to both of them creatively and why I wanted to work with both of them. Mark, I wanted to. Why you're attracted to something? I'm not going to waste time with this.
We'll leave.
Man, you guys got a real Whitney Houston, Bobby Brown thing going on.
Who's who?
Bobby. That's why I wanted to work with Kai and why I wanted to work with Mark, because they're both so creative. But they were getting so creative that it was derailing the script. And I took Mark aside on the third day and I said, "If you don't protect your script, I'm going to punch you in the fucking face."
Whoa!
Wow!
Yeah.
Wow! Am I allowed to cuss on this, Christian? That. I'm sorry.
It's because you got a concussion.
Yeah. I didn't hit him, and I would never hit him, but it just got to the point with me that I was really frustrated that he had written a solid script and he was getting caught up in the moment, or I don't know what was happening, but he at the time thought all these different changes that were on set were a great idea. And meanwhile, I'd paid somebody a fortune to schedule this and budget it. I don't have the time for them to take my...
So no improv. Let's chip chop and get to it. Okay.
Actors can improv, not the crew. It's just not the way it works. But sometimes I did let go of things that I didn't believe in. There's a shot in the movie that I never wanted that we filmed, and then my investor sent me an email like, why the hell do you do this in the movie? And I said, guys, and they're like, why, let's do it this way. And I said, guys, I love you, I agree with you, but we didn't shoot the other way. So it's got to be the way I don't like it. But
all right, so your husband's in the hospital then.
I don't even know what we're talking about anymore.
I know exactly. I walked him to the lake and I was like, you're the greatest writer and this is the greatest script. And
So you guys get back. So Marco's okay. He goes back to the original script. They shoot it. They get it done. And so everything's going as planned.
We didn't go back. I mean, they made drastic changes. So my answer to you was I did let things go in the creative process. Okay. And I feel like I was wrong. To let it go.
Oh.
Not like I was wrong to push for him to keep what he wanted. I feel like I was wrong to for that.
Okay, so never times you were like, that you went back and go, okay, that choice was good. Like, from the other side.
I mean, there were things I did that were wrong on set, absolutely.
No, but I mean, like, if someone else suggested, okay, I want to make this choice, and you were like, no, and it went through, it wasn't like, oh, I'm glad that I was wrong on that one.
I don't know if Gavin or Kai would disagree, but I think if Gavin and Kai really sold me on something, I was pretty good about going, actually, no, there was a huge thing that I fought against, mm-hmm. and I told them I would let them shoot it, and which was the scene, I don't know how much we should give away on this, but there's a scene where there's an alien ship and I'm involved and it gets very, very graphic.
Yeah.
And
really graphic.
And Mark didn't write it that way. And I was like, and the director said, I really want this scene to be there. I want this to be a real violation. And I was like, no. And he was like, Stacy, come on, Mark, you know, rallied with him. And I was like, listen, guys, I'll let you shoot it, but I have final veto. I have final cut.
And you liked the way it came out.
I did.
Okay.
So I was wrong about that for sure.
Okay, cool. So, yeah. There's definitely those moments. And then, so then it all goes through, and like the chemistry with the actors went, and the script kind of filled.
The actors were like, thank God for the actors.
Okay.
We became really good friends, and everybody was just on it.
Okay,
you know?
Thank God. So tell me about the last day of shooting. It's the last day you guys are.
That was my favorite, actually.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
How come?
It's funny because I was so
Of accomplishment, or
yeah, and I was trying to be so prepared. I was so like, and again, this is all, you know, my first lead in the film, so I learned from this experience what I would do differently next time. I was so like, you know, always like working on my lines and my, you know, like my objectives and intentions, like all my actor stuff, and I would just be like hunkered down in my room between takes, and then I went and bought booze for the after party and came back and shot like what to me is my best scene in the film, like the first time that I was like, if I had been that girl in the whole movie, I just would have been really happy, you know. And it was the scene on the alien ship, and that was the first time that I, like, watching the movie, I'm like, that's the scene to me that like works the most.
But you weren't hammered when you shot it.
The aliens
were
right.
yes was she was like, what?
No.
Nothing sounds more fun than a Michigan kegger with aliens in the woods.
Right?
That's true.
But that scene kind of made me realize,
that's
like...
That's the log line, by the way, of the script.
We shot that actually in a garage that our amazing production designer, Kevin Parsons, totally made over. And it was 42 degrees, and they had like a heater nearby, but I was basically wearing a garbage bag, and that was it.
I want to see this movie.
You've got to see it, Mark. So yeah, I was like, you know, getting abducted, and I was wearing like next to nothing. And to me, that was like... Like, I'm like, I wish I had been that actress the whole film, you know, because I just
feel
like...
You're having
fun. Yeah, and I just wasn't stressed, and I wasn't worried about it, and I was just so in the moment.
And that's where going back to our previous thing about when you have to...
You have to wear a lot of hats, yeah. Finally, the last day, you're just free to get abducted by aliens.
Right, today I'm an actress, and that's it.
That's it, Christian. Yeah, it's true.
Let me ask you about the aliens, because I know that you'd had a lot of the... you know, as far as how they were put together and how they look. Was there people in the suit?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you guys ever go drinking with them? Because that would have been fun, like with them in the suits.
No, two of the girls didn't love like being in the suit. They were a little uncomfortable.
We did the Greg Brady. You remember the Greg Brady episode where it's like he fit in the suit.
Yeah, you should have done pictures, by the way, like the Bigfoot stuff that they do. You should have done like fake YouTube videos.
Well, yeah, I'm saying, because you're in the woods in Michigan. Did the crew from Sightings ever come by and like, you know, investigate?
I actually saw a UFO for reals, but that's beside the point. So the
whole new podcast on that.
Yeah, the girls that we hired, we just needed somebody to fit in the suits. You know, so we found these two girls.
Well, the main one was designed for her because our creature designer, Barney Berman, knew Kasha. He had worked with her on Star Trek.
Right, exactly. Oh,
so she was an expert.
He had the cast and the cast of the face. And so he was able to, and then we cast her. So then Barney made these two little tiny suits, and he's like, you know, we're going to need
Warwick
small
Davis.
Right. So then, so we basically threw in these two sweet, sweet girls in the very first shot of the alien coming out. She literally did, and I wish I could, the people at home could see this. She literally did this.
She moved her hands around.
Moved her hands around. Spirit fingers. Yeah. And God.
See, those things like that. But it still would have been fun to have them walking around, like doing shots with the aliens.
All right, look, Christian, we'll do a prank with aliens later. We'll go to Applebee's dressed up as aliens.
All right,
it'll be fun.
Well, look, so we're at 12 o'clock here. So I want to talk about a couple more things. We get to cut. We're done. It's in the can. We're not even close to done with the rest of this.
Now you begin the arduous task of post-production.
Right. It starts. So take us into post-production.
So again, here was Stacy with the bad cop, and Mark was the good cop. we met with editors. We met with three different teams of editors, and we ended up going with two phenomenal guys, John Nelson and Jared Burt. And those two were just, you know, they banged it out. And I, of course, wanted everything yesterday, and Mark was, you know, wanting to give everybody more time. And I'm always of the school of thought that more time doesn't always equal better. So I wanted to get a cut done in, you know, 6 weeks, and Mark said, you know, oh, 2.5 months, and then so we settled on 8 weeks.
So you want to have the whole thing done in 8 weeks, not maybe the finished product,
just
but
a rough cut.
You can
just
watch.
A rough cut,
exactly,
yeah.
To see what's working, to see what's missing. So you know, we did the rough cut, and then Kai did a pass with the editors, and then we made changes after that second edit. So you know, and then we went into sound. I would say like March. So this is now like the guys started working in December and went through like February, March to get us the final cut.
Yeah,
now, is there more marital bliss at this point between you guys because you're working post production and you know you still have
it cooled off
ideas?
It was a lot better with the post,
yeah.
Because then it was kind of fun. We were going to our post house. We were watching the cuts that were coming in, and then
it was really creative. Like I was shocked at how creative post production is.
It really is. I mean, then towards the end, you know, I was making suggestions for editing cuts, and so was Stacy, and then. When we get into the sound mix and we're coming up with the ideas for how the aliens sound and then the music, I had a great friend, Zach Ryan, who did the score, which is absolutely phenomenal.
He's going to get an Oscar for music one day. I mean, he's just amazing.
Can you do an impression of how the alien sounds? Is it like the dragon call from the new Star Wars Blu-rays?
Don't do that. That's giving away our secrets. Don't tell him, nice. Mark, don't tell anyone what Mark just did. Because actually, Pat Jankowicz of Fangoria asked me what the sound was. And I was
really?
I can't tell you. Nice.
Keep it under wraps. Yeah. On DVD, October 11th, everybody.
Yeah, but it's kind of freaky. It's kind of freaky. And
then our sound guys, Tim Celestial and Del Cooper, and then
Tim Cooper, Del Celestial.
Sorry. And then also Rob Walker did all the alien ship scenes. So
yeah.
We had really good sound guys, and we got really lucky with our sound mixer. He was just a genius. Like, he took everything and whipped it together in like a month, because I had already set a date for a screening at the Arclight. So I gave everybody like 3 weeks at the very end there to get everything tightened up.
Yeah. But yeah, it all came together. I mean, some of the best parts were going and listening to the music,
right.
Which
well,
was like the
now,
last thing.
Now, here's something that too, in a smaller movie like this too. Like, I know that when you get, again, we can use the Nolan reference because we brought Nolan up before. Nolan comes into Dark Knight. Someone goes, "Hey, we want you to change. Fuck you." You know, like as for
where, that power.
Right now, when Kai is sitting there and he's like, you know, I'm sure he wanted his certain angles as to where I'm sure it's the reverse. Was there a lot of kind of back and forth, or were you guys on the same page of what angles and with the edits and? More of the edits, I think, too. Like, I'd rather have this shot. And did it work pretty well?
Yeah, it worked pretty well. I think ultimately we had the final say.
Okay.
Kai did do an edit. And, you know, I think everybody knows that we weren't thrilled with it. I mean, there were some amazing parts. But then it was like, okay, you had your pass. Now we're going to put some more stuff. Some more notes in, and then the editors came back in, and
the investors chimed in as well.
The investors chimed in, and so not that we were like not thrilled with Kai. It was just it was a very collaborative process.
It's a different creative vision.
Yeah,
right.
So how do you get to a point where it's like, okay, we're getting in there, we're going to make our changes, and now we've gotten to the point where we've made our changes. Now we like what we have. Now we're going to screen it for people in LA, and now we're going to do. More
that's got to be nerve-wracking. Like you said, you had a date at Arclight, which is the biggest movie theater in
Los Angeles.
You know, in Los Angeles.
Yeah,
it's huge. It looks like
out.
The damn Death Star from the outside.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So you have a screening at the Arclight. Are you sweating bullets that day?
Oh, I hate – I couldn't watch.
Yeah,
honestly, the worst thing I ever did was inviting the level of people I invited and then sitting in the room. Because, we invited some really big people that, you know, were great and showed up for us.
And you're proud of the film, but it's just nerve-wracking.
So
right?
Nerve-wracking. It's the first time seeing it. I mean, we had the biggest theater below the dome because people kept RSVPing. So.
Yeah, we had a lot of people show up, which was great.
But it was so stressful. I mean, I was in there.
How many people?
We had, I think the theater fit 450 people, and I think something like 470 had RSVP, but at the end of the day, it was like 380 or 400 came.
Okay, that's a pretty impressive turnout.
Yeah, we had a lot of support. You know,
okay,
a lot
great.
Of people came out, and I just think it was it was hard to watch.
It was. Right. And people were great. I mean, gave us great feedback afterwards, but it was just so stressful sitting there.
Well, so the screening happens. And then, so where's the after party? What happens at the after party? Who are you talking to? What's the next?
Who sleeps with who at the after party?
That's true. Give me a dirty story.
There's no drama. Oh, no.
I slept with my wife.
Oh, nice.
Actually, I don't think we did.
I think we ended up at Mel's Diner at 2 a.m. to get grilled cheese.
That's wearing the alien costume.
Yes. That's right. Oh, we actually did do a reshoot where I was actually poured into the alien costume.
Yeah.
By a makeup artist named Nick and Bernie Berman. They used like a bottle of baby powder. But
that's funny.
Yeah. Nice.
There's a good story.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
No, but then we, I got to work on selling it because I knew AFM was coming up and I started entering film festivals like a mad woman. And
we did make one change though after the screening.
Yeah.
Based on
notes.
Okay.
We got some feedback from certain people and so we made a few just minor mm-hmm. changes that were really easy to do. And then and then what Stacy said, we started sending them out to film festivals. And then we got rejected from a bunch of them, and we were like kind
of big ones. Be kind fair.
Big ones. But we were looking at each other. I remember getting rejected from one that wasn't really big, and I was like, I don't think we're gonna. And then all of a sudden, it just poured in. We got
one after
tons
another.
Of
really?
Film festivals.
Yeah,
and it's just a matter of knocking on their door hard enough to get them to notice you.
Yeah, and
how does one submit to a film festival for those people out there who are listening? Because there are a lot of people who are listening that know nothing about this area and they want to.
Process.
You know,
yeah.
Go to withoutabox.com
and you create an account, which is actually very cool because when we were doing this process, if you're not a big film or if you're not established filmmakers, you can't just go on IMDb because anybody would go on IMDb and say they're making a movie. So, you know, we had fought and fought to get on IMDb, but once you register on Without a Box, you're automatically registered with IMDb.
Oh,
so that's
cool.
A really cool process for anyone who has a short film or, you know, anybody that's trying to.
I did not know that.
Yeah, I'm a wealth of.
Two birds, one stone.
Wow.
So, because they're owned by the same company. So, you register with Without a Box.
I did not know that.
And then it's actually cool, too, because you can start searching their database. So, you can look at horror festivals, or you could look at drama, or you could look at documentary. They're really organized. It's fantastic. And then they will set reminders for the deadlines, like, oh, it's 2 days until your deadline, or it's 3 days. And obviously, I knew the gigantic festivals that, like, were my dream festivals. Toronto is my all-time favorite. And, you know, I submitted to the midnight program there, like fingers crossed, and they said no. But we had also submitted before we made the changes, whatever.
And you got a lot of yeses, though, too. So they screened it at all these festivals. And now are you guys going all across the country?
We were for a little bit there. I mean, we got into the Santa Fe Independent Film Festival. That was the first acceptance. And then the next week, Shriek Fest called us. And that was our big, like.
Where is Shriek Fest?
It's in Los Angeles.
It's in Los Angeles. Oh, it's a huge horror festival. Now it's in its 11th year.
Yeah. And then a great girl named Denise Gossett runs it. And we actually won Audience Choice Award there. So that was really helpful.
Wow. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, we won that. And then we won Best Feature at Santa Fe Film Festival. And then.
We were in six more festivals.
And then we were in six more that. Premiered.
Did you send a picture of your middle finger to everyone who said no?
We should have. maybe we will. Oh, we forgot to send this.
Hold on. Do you have a pen? I'm going to make a note.
Yeah.
But Christian, I wanted to answer your question further. Without a Box, it tells you the deadlines, and then you basically pay online and then send a DVD.
Great. So. Okay. So then.
And so then it makes the rounds in the festivals, right? And then now where do you go from? It's like, okay, we made a movie. It's screened. People
it goes
like
to festivals,
it.
Right. How do you sell it?
Where does the movie go?
Stacy then goes and sells it. And if anybody's lucky enough to have Stacy, seriously, she kicked ass.
I know a guy who is. He's sitting right next to me.
That's
you.
That's me.
Wait a minute. Yeah. No, we're talking
Breaking
about Mark Riley.
Story.
Yeah. His name is T-Bone and he's in prison. No, yeah.
That's me. So, yeah, AFM, I'm going to let my wife take over here. I just wanted to give praise because she actually kind of did all this research and I knew nothing.
I did.
I kind of just started working on my other projects and she would just say, Mark, go do this. And I go, okay.
Yeah, I mean, AFM, the American Film Market, for anyone who doesn't know, is usually the first week of November. It's like, I think November 2nd or 3rd to 7th this year. It is amazing. I mean, there's everyone in the city and from all over the world that's in distribution, and they're all in one hotel. They're in the Lowe's Hotel in Santa Monica. And so I have a phenomenal mentor, Gary Rubin, that kind of guided me through what I needed to do to get the film ready and to have everything I needed. So, you know, the AFM website will say, oh, pick a few scenes and have a 7-minute reel. And I was like, oh, hey, Gary, I'm going to do like a 7-minute reel. And he's like, buy an iPad, make a 3-minute trailer, bring screeners.
That's it.
That's it. And I was like, he goes,
good advice.
Yeah, he's like, Stacy, get an iPad. And I'm like, do you have one? He's like, no. But everyone that comes into my office, I always think it's brilliant. Get an iPad. So
he's a sales guy. He was a distributor. Distributor. Yeah. So he knows what.
Yeah,
to
he
look
knows
for.
what works when people come into his companies. So I got Jared to cut an extended trailer that really heightened the horror of the film because I was really pushing that. Since that's why we made a horror film without stars. Horror is really the one genre that translates all over the world, that people will always see, always rent, always buy without any names attached. If you do a drama, comedy, you better have gigantic people.
Right.
So Jared cut this phenomenal 3.5-minute, crazy, spooky extended trailer. And I got to AFM and I wore heels for 7 days straight and wanted to die by the end of the day. But I had 27 meetings in 6 days. Oh. And at the end of the market, the day after the market, I got my first offer. It was the company I ended up closing with. And then I had 7 other offers after that. So 27 meetings led to 8 offers.
So what is that? You can be as specific as you want, but like, what does that like include? Like an offer? Like what do they want? What could they want? You know what I mean? Like you don't have to go into your specific deal if you don't want it. But I mean, as far as I'm curious, like,
what does the deal do for you? Like, does it distribute the DVD for you?
What do they say? Like, okay, we'll give you X amount and with that you'll get this, we get this. Like, what are some of the things that can be offered?
Yeah, right? No, that's a good question. Well, first of all, I have to like give a real shout out to the guy, Jared, who did the trailer for me, because out of 27 meetings, not one person said not interested. Everybody asked for a screener. So, everybody,
wow, that's good.
27 screeners I gave out. My computer died after AFM, but.
Did it really?
Yeah, it did. It crashed. It was the DVD burner. Yeah, I was like, done. The offers range from anything from small offers called a minimum guarantee, which means, you'll get money up front and then the company will distribute the movie internationally. And then as the money starts to come back in, they'll recoup what they paid you. And then you'll start getting money after that and they'll take a percentage of that. Or, after the market tanked, with the big recession 2008, things changed so much from the time we shot this movie to the film market now. Nobody is really giving minimum guarantees for films without stars. So with our deal, it's more of a straight distribution where we get a percentage of profits. They'll take a small marketing fee, which I always negotiate down because I don't pay full price. You never take the first offer out of the gate. Always negotiate. So they will give you an offer and say, okay, we'll take, this percentage of every dollar that's made and then this marketing fee, but we'll take it all over the world. So a lot of people wanted it worldwide. I only did my foreign sales deal then because that was what I was focusing on. So I closed with my amazing foreign sales agents, Moving Pictures, which they also have Moving Pictures magazine, and now they're technically called ICAP Media. Mm-hmm. So they got us theatrical in Germany. We're all over Asia, Japan, China.
So is it in theaters now, or is it?
Where is it in Germany?
To be honest, I do not know exactly when it.
Let's take
was.
A trip.
Yeah, right.
Go to Germany.
We're theatrical in Germany, so we're actually in a theater.
Is it going to be in subtitles?
Yes.
Well, if there's any German listeners out there, let us know if you have seen Grey Skies in the theater and when it was out. I want to know that.
Please.
Okay. Well,
and for people in the States, how do you get your hands on Grey Skies?
Well, that's what I was just about to say. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. So now the DVD. So this company that you signed with is also distributing the DVDs. Yes.
No, they're just doing my foreign deal.
Oh, just the foreign. So who's doing it? Who's doing the DVDs here?
So we had a few offers. I talked to a few different companies, and we ended up really liking the people at Osiris Entertainment.
Okay.
Every time I call in or email, I get the main owner or the vice president. I always deal directly with these guys. They've been really hands on. They're doing a whole DVD release October 11th. Right as of now, it's in Walmart Canada, which is great. We're trying to get Walmart North America.
Hey.
And Walmart
in Canada,
right?
Yeah, that's
crazy.
Huge.
That's
so
big.
The big thing is here is Amazon.com,
okay,
and OsirisEnt.com, which is Osiris Entertainment.
So if you want to get your hands on Grey Skies the movie, go to Amazon.com and check it out. Are there any other names? Grey Skies is the only. You guys are the only ones.
There is one called Grey Skies: The Alien Conspiracy, but it has a terrible alien on the cover, and it's from 2001.
All right, so it would be Grey Skies 2010?
10 or 2011.
Okay. Is it Grey with an A or an E?
Good question.
G-R-E-Y. Same way Jennifer Grey spells her last name, right?
That's right.
All right, so check that out. Go to Amazon.com.
Or OsirisEnt, which is OsirisEnt.
I'm going to go ahead and say that Amazon's probably a little more easy to remember.
Yes.
But we'll try the other one as well.
Yeah,
I'll try.
That's true.
And it's available for pre-order now.
Okay, good.
October 11th.
So there you go. So how about that? We just took you within an hour and a little under how to...
We made an independent podcast.
Yes, we did. Well done, guys. Golf clap.
Golf clap.
Okay. I'm pretty excited about that, yeah.
All right.
Just crazy. Like, is, you know, we do the podcast and we complain, man, I don't know if I can do, you know, 2 hours worth of a podcast.
Do another classic review.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go shoot a movie in Michigan in the middle of nowhere.
Took years off my life, I swear.
Well, thank you guys, though, very much for coming in and talking to us about that, because that's really cool. I know that we have a lot of listeners who are curious about making films, want to know how to kind of break in on doing it. So I can guarantee that this was very helpful to them. Aww. So thank you.
Thanks, yeah, Christian. Hopefully. Thanks, Mark. Thank you guys for having us.
No problem. But we're not done yet, because we're going to talk going to talk about...
I was halfway out the door. What?
You're good. You can leave. We've had you on already. We want to talk to you, beautiful wife. We want to talk about some of our favorite independent films.
Yes.
Now, these can be ones... We each get one to talk about, and everybody can kind of sound off on it. One of your favorite independent films that you remember that was kind of set the bar, whatever it is.
It is not named Gray Skies or Little Fucker.
Yes. And independent films, by the way, can also be, you'd be surprised at some of these. Like Terminator is an independent film, by the way. A lot of people don't realize that. The first Terminator.
That's so it's Star Wars.
So the Star Wars.
Technically.
Well, they know, but they still had Fox behind them.
They had Fox, yeah. They had Laddie.
THX 1138. That was definitely independent.
Right. So, okay. Well, that being said, we'll let ladies first.
Oh no, I didn't even know we were talking about this. I need time.
Do you want time? Okay, that's fine. It's like a restaurant. It's like come back to me later.
By
okay.
the time you're done ordering, I'll be ready.
I will start with a spinach artichoke dip, though.
Now, I'm a little back and forth here. If I was going to start, Clerks to me was something that I just.
How many movies are you going to take before anybody else can? You get one movie to talk about.
I'm going right now. It's Precious.
He's going to list off 15 movies, so he sounds like the smart one, and then he's going to talk about one.
Well, Clerks was something that I would want to talk about, but Reservoir Dogs to me is one of my favorite, if not the best, independent film, because it's just one of those movies that. You just knew it was something special from the second you saw it. From everyone involved, you knew the Tarantino writing, the directing. I mean, it was intense. And you talk about an independent film with a cast that should have cost about $200 million.
Yeah.
So it's one of my favorites.
Yeah. All right.
Special?
Yeah, I was going to go with Clerks.
Oh, that's why he got mad at me.
Because Clerks, it looks like it was just made by a fan. It looks like it was, you know, obviously dirt cheap, but it's, you know, it was very inspiring to watch, because if you are funny, then you can get something made and have it be appreciated by people. So it's kind of cool to see that. And, you know, I never saw Clerks 2. I don't know if anybody saw Clerks
2. No one
too.
Needs to see Clerks 2. I saw it.
It's not an independent film,
No, it's not an independent film.
No, it was terrible. Kevin Smith.
And it has a donkey in it. It's awful.
No.
Well, despite that, I don't think it's that good. But, so, you know, Clerks for me is probably my favorite.
Okay.
Yeah.
Marcellus Ellis? Oh, that's you.
Marcellus.
His name is Marcellus Wallace.
Yeah, Marcellus Wallace Reilly.
I got mine. Go ahead.
Okay.
I'm going to stick with the horror genre.
Good.
And I'm going to go
Texas
with
Chainsaw.
Halloween.
Whoa.
You stop trying to sound
sorry.
Smart,
sorry, I apologize.
Other people.
He beat me to it.
Halloween. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, but I'll let you announce it.
Oh my God.
Very angry today.
Take a break.
I love
Ichabod
it.
Ichabod Crane over here.
Well, he just gets the computer, and so he thinks he's smarter than everybody.
Archie!
To the moon, Alice.
So you're going
to
go Halloween because...
So I'm going Halloween because it was an independent movie. It was shot...
directed by John Carpenter.
Directed by John Carpenter. Thank you, awful. Christian. Written by John Carpenter. The Halloween theme that everybody in the mm-hmm. world knows now mm-hmm. was written by John Carpenter, and he performed it. He put together... It was like...
That's him playing the piano?
That's him playing the piano.
Wow.
He put together this crazy, you know... It was a very quick shoot, you know. It was shot all over L.A. and Pasadena, and it became the highest grossing film.
Highest grossing.
Highest grossing.
It's like Count Chocula all of a sudden.
I know. All of a sudden. I don't know what happened
it's
there.
Highest grossing film.
I was just channeled by a spirit.
Well, we're trying to get a distribution deal for Gray Skies in South America, so we're just appealing.
Yeah, I know.
Come on, Argentina. Get on the boat.
Yeah, come on, please. at the time, I guess, it became like one of the the highest grossing horror films of all time because of the budget, which I wish I could... quote the budget. I don't know what it was, but it was
$8 and a evil mask.
It was very small.
All right.
That's what I do know.
And ladies, not first, last but not least.
I have so many, but they all have a one thing in common. I would say my top three are Taxi Driver, Reservoir Dogs, and Pulp Fiction.
Pulp Fiction. Again, Tarantino.
You like violence.
I'm desperate to make a gangster, like a badass gangster movie.
Yeah.
I love me some Scorsese and Tarantino. Like, honestly, nobody does it better than those two. And I just remember being like 15 or 16 when I saw Reservoir Dogs and Taxi Driver, and just being blown away that that's like that movies could go there.
Right.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, so. That's the beauty of independent.
It is the freedom. Yeah.
Well, that's
the freedom
of it. You know, it's a little different now. Some people, of course, will argue that like certain movies, you know, like Pulp Fiction or whatnot,
isn't
aren't so much. Yeah, I don't feel that way. I agree with you. I think it's a great independent film.
Yeah, because at the time, Miramax wasn't a
right.
major studio,
and it got and it, yeah, exactly. And it, like between that and Clerks, that kind of put it on the map.
Yeah.
And because, you know, there's such huge stars now that people don't associate that. You associate something like the Blair Witch as like an
right.
independent.
No
because
names.
People still don't know who any of those people are.
But it is a great independent
I almost
film.
I almost yeah, said because sure. that was for what it was made for, you know, and then Paranormal Activity yeah. later did the same mm-hmm. thing.
Well, I think isn't Blair Witch like still to this day the most profitable movie of all time, I think?
The most profitable, I think, quote-unquote independent.
Well, yeah. I mean, right. But in general, though, because
of budget to how much you spent to make it versus how much it made, I think Blair Witch
yeah,
did.
Like,
I'd look at that.
Maybe more than Avatar?
But Avatar cost like four...
Well,
200,
so proportionally, I know
right.
what you're saying.
Well, profitable.
But
I mean,
maybe Paranormal Activity now...
Maybe, but I still think it's Blair Witch because I think Blair Witch costs a lot less.
Well, they all made more money than they're making today.
That's right. Okay.
I'm going to Google that.
That being said, this was a really fun podcast because we found a whole bunch of stuff that we didn't know before. We got to talk about some of our favorite independent films.
And let's make Grey Skies the most profitable independent movie of
all time. Mark Ellis.
Hey.
Go on
Amazon.com.
That's right, guys. Go on Amazon.com.
Go to Canada and Walmart. Go to Germany and see it.
Yes. Go to OsteriaMoza.com and find out. What was it?
Osteria.
That's a restaurant.
Osiris Ents.
Go to Amazon. Check out Grey Skies. Look at the trailer on YouTube. And remember to subscribe to us on iTunes if you aren't already. Rate, comment it. We comment for sure because we want to hear what you guys are. There any aspiring filmmakers out there? Let it rip in Schmoville and don't go.
Yeah, thank you, Mark Reilly. All of our fans were wondering. You know, look, the guy's great talking about X-Men. Can he do anything else? And I think, yeah.
Yeah, I can.
Well, I would like to
he can write and have his wife do all the hard stuff.
And threaten to punch him in the face.
Thank you very much.
That's right. Thank you very much, Katie, our producer.
Thanks, yes. Katie.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Stacy. Thank you, Lil Chimp.
You're welcome.
And thank you, Christian.
And that being said, we'll see you next time, guys.
You're an ape.
There you go.